Hello friends, welcome to virtual classroom of Clinical Pharmacology. This will be the last discussion in our series on clinical trial risk management. In this discussion, we shall talk about how to manage clinical trial site risk. So, in this topic, we are going to discuss about how to prepare a risk profile of a particular site during site qualification visit. And then after that risk prevention plan as per the risk profile structure at the time of site qualification visit. Then we will also discuss on during ongoing monitoring how to correct the plan according to the various risk profile noticed at the time of ongoing monitoring. And we shall also discuss about management of fraud this if might happen that during the clinical trial. So basically here the important part is the clinical research associate. So he will be very much playing a very important role in micromanagement of investigational site which are involved in the clinical trial. And the CRA has the opportunity of accomplishing this by frequent contact with the site throughout the project. So, the risk management mentality, it can be adopted from day one during initial assessment of the suitability of the site, then throughout the study. So, usually a role of a CRA, it has been viewed as a detector of error and then a facilitator of resolution of those issue, whether they involve resolution of data discrepancy between source and CRA, various protocol violations, then adverse event, then IP management, site documentation and so on. However, the role of CRA should be switched from remediation and correction to the prevention. So, in this discussion we shall talk about how CRA can play a preventive role so that there are no error in the clinical trial. So, first job of CRA is to identify a potential site. So, this identification of potential site is done by the site qualification visit, which is also called pre-study selection visit. So, usually how to identify site for clinical trial? So, there are various approaches done by CRA. One of the approaches to scroll through the databases which are available for clinical trial registry like clinicaltrials.gov and CTRI, then European Union registry and so on. Another source for site is the referral from other investigator or from other colleagues in the industry. Then third one is a literature search where you can identify particular article and where those study was done, which case this can be also useful as an site resource. Then conference list. So these are the sources which one uses to identify the site. So, the only purpose of site qualification visit is to prepare a risk profile of particular site so that when it is decided that the study should be taken at a particular site. So, according to that one can prepare the prevention plan for that particular site. So, this is very crucial stage at the time of site qualification visit. So, initially we can only understand the suitability of the potential site as per the initial exchanges between sponsor and the investigator. So, initial interest is very much important. So, it depends on various aspects like what is the rapidity of response to the question or information which a site gives to the CRA. This can indicate the initial interest of the site. Another thing is return of phone calls and also asking to the sponsor about the protocol and what are the next steps. So, these are all early indicator of investigator if he is interested, really interested in doing the clinical trial. So, if there is any party slow, so suppose site is very slow to respond to any very straightforward and simple request. So, this may say that there can be so many problem can involve whenever some complicated activities will be there. So, this can be give an idea to CRA that whether he or she should go with that particular site or not. So, So after initial responses, and if it is found that okay, it is fine, then there are several other indicators also which can give idea about the potential side. So one is the ease of communication. So this is important point, because there will be lots of communication between CRA and the sponsor, and the sponsor and then investigator. So how it is easy, does it require any appointment or any time lag, whatever. So this can be a very good indicator of the particular side. Another point is ease of scheduling visit. If investigator is not giving time to CRA for any visit, then it's an indicator that things won't be easy when the actual study is done. Then spending quality time by PI and the site team. Many a times what happens that PI gives only 15 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, and which is not sufficient. So they promise to spend 1 or 2 hours, but they don't do. So in that case, it can also give an idea that how is the interest of the particular PI. If any PI, if he introduces CRA to the team and spend a good quality of time, it indicates that the PI is really interested, and there will be less complex, there will be less complication if the site is taken for SIV. Then the knowledge. So whenever there is a discussion between PI and the CRA regarding the protocol, even if it is a draft, okay. So if the PI is having knowledge about the protocol, so it shows that whatever he has mentioned in the CV about the experience, there is a really experience of that investigator in the protocol. And it also shows its interest and things to take care when there are certain complications. Then the knowledge of GCPA is very important, because all regulatory studies, these are the very critical aspect, because if the person is having knowledge of GCP, then there are less chances of fraud than other deviation. Then the regulatory issue. So if the investigator has idea about a very regulatory issue, then it is very easy for a site, for a sponsor, whenever there is any regulatory inspection, so that site is already having experience of taking those inspections. So this is also a plus point before at the time of SQE. Then the attitude towards the protocol and the clinical trial subject. So attitude is very much important, because you can select for attitude and then you can train for the skill. So attitude is extremely important for a particular site. Then the cooperation. So these are the indicator and some of several point which can help a CRA to select a potential site. Then after selection of a particular site, the next step is to prepare the risk profile of the particular site. Now, if the site has already been taken by sponsor in an earlier clinical trial, so the sponsor will have some idea about advantages and disadvantages, strengths or weaknesses of the particular site. However, if the site is very new and it's first time that the sponsor is dealing with the investigator, there won't be any background. So it is very much necessary that background work should be done, and a risk profile should be prepared for the particular site. So there are several parameters, like one thing is what is the potential to recruit sufficient number of eligible patients. So CRA can visit OPD and he or she can look at the OPD and the number of OPD patients which comes to the site. This will give an idea that what can be the recruitment rate, whatever is PI is saying, whether it can really match with the actual number in the clinical trial or not. So this is one of the indicator which can give about the risk profile of the particular site. Then organizational ability. So if there is an institutional, if the institute is big and reputed, then it can have many resources and many good investigator, knowledgeable people will be there. So this is also a plus point. Then confidentiality. So here the thing is that clinical trial, the confidential is very much important. So there should be a proper rooms available, wards dedicated for clinical trial, which actually gives benefit for the confidentiality. Then investigational, that is IP product storage and management capability. Many a times if there is injectable or some other vaccine like study, so the storage of IP is very critical. It has to be stored in a particular temperature environment, which is a particular humidity and etc. So a dedicated room available for IP is very much required. Then there should be a backup of that power. Sometimes backup of backup should be also there. So this is a very plus point in site qualification with it. So, if the site is not having this IP storage facility, then it should be mentioned in that report of SQV, so that a project manager can have an idea, okay, if suppose a site has to be developed, then what kind of equipment sponsor has to provide to the particular site. Then patient treatment facility, whenever patient is admitted and trial is gone and fed SI occurs, the patient might require a ICU in case of SI. He might require also a surgical operation, surgical facility will be also required. So this will be like you know, very much crucial for patient's safety point of view, that if anything goes wrong, then sites would have all those facilities to take care of that worst part. Then conflict with the competing studies. Many times if a cancer study, so many times in the same indication two studies are ongoing, so there is a conflict, so of the competing studies, so it has to be there at the time of SQV. Then safety reporting. So all these factors based on that, and CRA can also add some of the things in that risk profile, and should prepare the risk profile. And one of the points is also risk profile, which is not mentioned here, is that the qualification and the experience of clinical trial team. So if the clinical trial team is experienced in having the same study conduct, then there will be less challenges during the clinical trial. So the first step of a CRA during SQV is that they should prepare a risk profile, so that as per the risk profile, one can manage a prevention plan, which is the next step. So preparation of a risk prevention plan, so this is usually conducted at the time of site initiation visit. So at the time of SCIV, and there are several objectives, but the first important objective is that there should be training of clinical trial staff. So this is one of the objective of SIV, and after that a risk prevention plan should be taken care of. And in the risk prevention plan, it actually depends on the previous risk profile which was conducted at the time of SQV. So what happens that for example, that CRF filling is a risk, because there can be lots of query can be generated if the CRF filling is not conducted properly. So if the trial team is new and the trial is complex, design is complex, so CRF filling can generate more queries, and which can delay the project timeline. So a risk mitigation can be, a live demo can be given to a trial team, and a person can be identified who will be responsible for the CRF filling, and he or she can be directly educated for the CRF filling. One of the point is like whenever there is a study like reconstitution of medication in case of an ND cancer study injectable, so unblinding will be there at the time of reconstitution, and after that it will be blinded study. So how to do this reconstitution should be demonstrated to the pharmacist, so that there are less error at the time of monitoring. Then under reporting of ASA, many times it happens that investigator feel that some of the symptoms are not adverse event. It's a usual thing. It can happen with the drug, but it has to be communicated to the investigator that it doesn't matter whether it is as usual or not. If it is an AE, then it has to be reported. So if there is underreporting of this AESI, then it can taken very badly with the regulatory team, and it is not desirable. Mm-hmm. And it can also impact the data quality. So it is very important that such kind of education is given to all those clinical trial team members, so that there is a proper trial is conducted. So according to all these risk profile, one can prepare the plan, and then plan can be demonstrated to clinical trial team. So here CRA can definitely add many things. I'm just giving as an format of this risk prevention plan. So after the preparation of risk prevention plan, the next step is like during the ongoing monitoring visit. So during ongoing monitoring visit, the CRA should try to correct their risk prevention plan as per that present risk profile. So there should be continuous risk assessment of the particular site. So here we can see that whenever a first patient is enrolled, after that if monitoring is happened, and then there can be lots of challenges at the time of first patient. So there will be lots of query in the CRF, protocol compliance and management of IP, then subject compliance and data collection. So first penetrating visit can be looked on as the initial session of training and coaching by the CRA for the site staff to ensure that they learn the appropriate standards and requirement of the trial. So the role of CRA is to support and encourage the site to minimize the error. So thereby it will reduce the threat for the successful conduct of the study. So by focusing on the major threat at the particular site, a CRA is able to prioritize its own workload and ensure the risk to the clinical trial subject caused by human factors, they are kept a very minimum. So the investigator side, it benefits by the increased performance level. So the concept of risk reduction by this approach or to monitoring is shown in the figure, that when you do a many monitoring visit initially, then there are chances of errors are reducing. So this is really important any complex study. So the key message is that the first monitoring visit should be conducted as early as possible, and it should be very much frequent during the initial part of the recruitment at the particular site. Now, investigator, the CRA can change the risk profile of particular site by several parameters. So one of the parameter is the analysis of the CRA filling. So what happens that when CRA is doing monitoring, and after the monitoring, when the CRA, the queries will be generated at the time of monitoring also, then those CRF pages will be given to the data management team, and the data management will do so many checks and edit checks, and after that also some queries will be found. So by analysis of the CRF pages by CRA as well as data management team will give an idea that how is the risk profile of CRF filling is there at the particular site. So based on that, if there is a need, then site has to be trained once again for CRF filling. Then whenever there is a protocol amendment, and if it's a major amendment, if there is change in the any procedure or any inclusion criteria, then it changes the risk profile of a particular site. Site has to be trained once again so that there is a lesser risk of any error. Then turnover of site staff. Site staff may get changed many a times. So if there is any change in the site staff, then CRA has to go there and train that particular site. Then certain other things like any information about the investigational product, or changing the CRA itself, then changing the site's facility, changing the site's attitude to the protocol or the sponsor. This all can give an idea about changing the risk profile. And one more important part is whenever there is a very high recruitment, it also gives an indicator that something is going wrong, as well as whenever there is a lower level of recruitment, it can also show that maybe there will be lesser interest of the sponsor, of the investigator to the sponsor, or there may be conflict with some competing study. Now, fraud in clinical research, which is rare, however, CRA should know how to detect those fraud and then how to manage those fraud. So in subsequent slide, we will discuss on identification and management of fraud. So after doing all these things, one of the very important point is to manage fraud. So fraud is also very much risky in clinical trial because of several factors, obviously. However, the good part is the percentage of the probability of fraud is very much lesser in clinical research, but it is still there. So it is very important for the CRA, because the CRA is a frontline soldier. Not only in creating GCP compliance relationship with the investigator, but also detecting any study conduct discrepancies. Okay, so this is because they are usually the only sponsor representative who are in frequent contact with the study staff and regularly inspect the site. So from this, it's very important for the CRA that he should be trained he should be trained for detecting any signs of this fraud. So however, this should not be confused with any dirty data, because there can be very protocol violation or CRF error will be there if the site is busy. So this is something different than the fraud. So now we'll take example of the fraud. So falsification of qualification, and then falsification of study staff involvement, non-recording of adverse event, then falsification of tampering of source data or CRF entries, then invention of data for non-existential patient, then use of documents from non-study patient, then reuse of the same source data for more than one study patient. So these are the examples of fraud. So whenever these things happen, it is very much important that it should be taken in a proper way. Now, the very critical part in the fraud management is how to identify fraud. So there are various parameters, and it is not restricted and limited. Like whenever there is a very low skin failure, right, when compared to other side, you can also identify that something wrong is going on at a particular site. Maybe staff is getting changed and it is not properly trained and something like that. Then the pharmacy dispatch, it does not match with the treatment days in the patient. So this is one of the things. Then ECG staff doesn't mention the name of the patient. So it can be there that it has to that ECG is used for multiple patients. Then several assessments done at the same time in a day, which is also not possible, because one can only do assessment at one time of only one patient. So there cannot be one more than one. So it is very important that whenever some assessment is recorded, the time should be there, so one can identify that it is not at the same time in the same day. Then patient diary and questionnaire completed in the same handwriting, you can also indicate the fraud. Then impractically large number of patients in only in one day, which is also not possible, and that a person is with limited staff, he or she has reviewed so many patients in particular day. Then CV does not show the specialization in area of required expertise. So if they, for the sake of a clinical trial acceptance, people may not write the specialization in oncology, so it can also identify that there can be fraud. Then several patients with identical vital signs. So all these are the some example which can help CRA to identify that some fraud is going there. Now, once a fraud is identified, the important part is how to manage this fraud. So in the first step is that there should be identification. Now, once something is identified, whether this is a fraud or this is some data error, there is a very thin line in the distinction. So it is not like that whenever some discrepancy is there, it is always a fraud. So one has to be very much careful while labeling any discrepancy as a fraud. So the first step should be that there should be a general question. So and they should raise a very question in a very general way with the study staff to further understand how a discrepancy may have arisen. And if the CRA is not satisfied with the reply, then they can make a discussion with the investigator and then inform the project manager as soon as possible. And very important part is that CRA should keep all these things in a confidential way, and they should be and he should be informing only those who are need to know, because the objective of this investigation is not a witch hunt but to discover the truth. So because many times what happen that the reputation of innocent person will be harmed. So this is not the objective. So it is not a witch hunt, it is just to discover the truth. So it is very important that one should label when it is fraud. Then once it is there, then there should be proper escalation to any team member in the sponsor team or any ethics committee or regulatory agency. And after that, a sponsor can close their particular site and then they report to the regulatory agency. So these are the general principle of management of fraud. And the sponsor should have SOP which will tell that how to detect and how to manage the fraud if there is any case of fraud. Now, so as we discussed earlier, that the role of CRA is not only the detector and the facilitator but also act as a preventer. So how to prevent the fraud at particular site? So very important part is the selection of site. So site selection is extremely important. Because if the site is GCP compliant, if there is a reputation of the particular site, if the institutional site is there, then there are less chances that there will be fraud during the study. Then one should also understand the difference between expectation and the reality. One cannot expect a site to recruit a very high number of patients in a very low number of time, and also not giving a proper compensation to the investigator and then demanding more. So one should also strike a balance between expectation and the reality. Then the GCP training. GCP training is extremely important. The site staff should be trained adequately, and they should be told very clearly that this is not acceptable as per the regulatory agency, as per the guideline. So one should avoid doing all those activity. at the time of training. Then audit trail, by ECRF gives excellent opportunity for the audit trail, so this can easily prevent the fraud. Then one should also create an environment of accountability. So this can be only conducted with the proper relationship, the investigator and the site team, proper training, and selecting those sites who are having prior experience in dealing with this regulatory agency. So these are several factors which can help in prevention of the fraud. So in summary, the first step of trial site management is like CRS should develop a risk profile of a particular site, and then as per the risk profile, one should prepare a risk prevention plan at particular site, and then after implementation of the plan, during ongoing monitoring visit, as per the change in the risk profile of that particular site, one should change the particular plan. And one of the important point is detection and management of fraud, because fraud is a very major risk, which is actually fortunately rare. So the procedure for handling all those fraud, it should be documented in the SOP. And if the fraud is suspected, then issue should be handled very carefully and confidentially with the sensitivity, with the aim of uncovering the only the truth without doing witch hunt. So that was all for today's discussion, friend. I hope you do like this video. So I would like to request to click on like button if you like this video, and you can also subscribe my YouTube channel if you want to have such amazing videos in the future. So thank you very much. Have a nice day.